Hey, brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick here in the Philippines. Hope you guys are doing all right. By the grace of God, I'll be there in the United States within the next 2 weeks. Brothers and sisters, ask for your prayers as we, I guess we need to move our stuff to the orphanage. Most of the stuff I've got, of course, I'll give it to the orphanages, our beds and stuff, add them there, things like that. I've got some things we want to preserve by the grace of God. With all those orphans, I don't know how we're going to do it. We're trying to figure it out. That our stuff won't be destroyed. what little earthly possessions I would like to keep till I come back to visit. I've got books and stuff, reference books and things like that. Anyway, brothers and sisters, praise God. It's a blessing to see you guys again today, or that, you know, you would see me, I guess. It's like talking to someone who you can't see them, but there's so many of you that I communicate with. I know you. Through the internet, and I've said this before, when, you know, of course the internet's been around a while now, whatever, 20, people's been practically using it for, because I think it was invented in 1969 or something like that, but actually being, by DARPA, but actually being used, let's say 20 years, and I never thought when I first heard people talking about social network and all that, I thought, that's insane. You know, that's like a, not the real world, and how can you deal with people? You know, it's like a fantasy world or whatever. But in reality, it's just like talking to someone on the phone, but, you know, you're doing it through writing, like texting or anything else. And you can make friends to the internet. So I thank the Lord for that. All of you guys, almost all of you who are watching this, of course, you're using these the internet as part of you. It's become integrated into our lives. And this, there's the blessings and the cursings of that. So I ask all of you guys to pray. For all the people who would watch these videos, all the people who would join us at Church of the Firstborn, the link is below the video here. We have, we can take prayer requests. We have a chat room. We haven't really been using it much, but you can go on there and chat anytime. And two different ones, you guys, you can chat on there if you wanted to make it a public thing. Then, you know, you could ask for people's, you know, maybe can IM people or whatever. But anyway, brothers and sisters, the... I ask you to pray, you know, about the negative forces of the internet. There's lots of guys, especially guys, you know, who mentioned to me that I visited and talked to. It's a big problem, and I've seen the statistics. I can't remember what it is. There's a huge amount of people, especially men, who look at pornography and stuff like that on the internet, who are supposed to be Christians and even pastors. It's a huge thing, and I ask you to pray about that, because the internet is, you know, it's the biggest thing on the internet is actually pornography. But of course, we are using it, and if you're watching this video, of course, it's being used to bring forth the gospel. So I ask you guys to pray about that, that that people can overcome that. And that's why, you know, I've often thought, I've mentioned this to some people. I don't know if I've ever mentioned it in a video or not, but up until the sexual revolution of like the 1960s, and, you know, I keep mentioning that book that I wrote, because that's what really the theme of my book is, really. I mean, it goes back to what I'm talking about. It's Satan's plan for the ages. And, you know, think about this. I mean, if you can. I mean, the Playboy didn't come out till 1957 or whatever it was or something. Maybe 55, whatever. Anyway, it doesn't really matter. There were, you know, there were men who lived their whole life, and women too, or whatever. I'd never seen a naked man or woman as a child or as a teenager unless maybe, you know, their children, brothers and sisters or whatever, maybe when they took a bath or whatever, but... There are people, you know, that grew up and never saw a naked woman until they got married, and vice versa. And that was the case in, you know, most of your countries with morality, not in the Romans, you know, they had all these orgies and all that kind of stuff, whatever, the Greeks and all this. But I'm talking about in lots of cultures. Let's just talk about our modern day Western culture. The people, you know, there was no photography, there was no videos, and even those things are only like 100 years old or so. A movie, and still they're nothing like the things they have today. So that's not, there's, you know, some people who, there are people who are very judgmental of other people, and, you know, there's the two sides of this. You know, there are people who are very judgmental and perfect and self-righteous, and then there's those who are greasy gracers who make an excuse for everything. But I, by the grace of God, we have to have balance and all that. So I will say this, that there's no generation that has to deal with the temptations that people do in this generation. technology-wise. Of course, it's only been in the last 20 or so years you can sit in your own house and on demand look at pornography on the internet by yourself and no one's in the room. You know, you can hide from people. Before, when they had these stag movies, they called them, they weren't that bad anyway compared to anything like today. You know, then it came out videotape. People had video players. They could watch it in the privacy of their home instead of going to a movie theater. But all this is still even modern. You're talking, you know, 75 years ago, there was no pornography. There was probably, you know, I guess people did paintings before photography came out 100 years ago, whatever, 150 years ago. People would maybe did some drawings of a naked person or whatever, but, you know, which they had these hieroglyphs or whatever. But people's temptation today, brothers and sisters, is 1,000 times more than it's ever been in any history of the people. Look at the easy access to drugs, all this instant stuff, the negative part of the modern day technology we have. Anyway, brothers and sisters, I ask you to pray for our brothers and sisters, because the temptation is, like I said, 1,000 times higher than any generation has ever endured. And the Lord knows that. That's not an excuse. It doesn't give anyone who's watching this video an excuse to look at pornography. It doesn't give you an excuse to whatever you might do drugs because you can. It's legal. Like as an example, now drugs are legal in some states, and I guess it's going to be legal everywhere. And gay marriage is gonna be legal everywhere and all that. That doesn't give people an excuse to say it's not a sin, that it's not wrong. But we must be aware that the level of temptation is higher. And for those who are very judgmental, to realize that, you know, except for the grace of God, you would be the same way. As Paul didn't say it like that, but in Paul, I believe it's Romans chapter 15, or 14 or 15 verse 1 or somewhere along in there, Paul said, you know, that because of the grace of God, I am what I am. So God is the one who calls us. God is the one who called us out. And that's really what a saint is, a called out one, a chosen one, a holy one, a separated one. So God is the one who chose us for that calling, brothers and sisters. We didn't choose ourselves, as Jesus told his disciples. Remember, you didn't choose me, I chose you. So the Lord chose us. So praise God for that. So let's endure, brothers and sisters. Let no man steal your crown. And that's really what I wanted to talk about. I had this vision. And like I said, I usually always have like a preamble. I guess that's what you could call it, what I just did. And there's people who run to and fro. They want to hear a vision, you know. But I had a vision from the Lord. And brothers and sisters, I've said this before. I've got words from the Lord about a quick revival before the rapture. I want the rapture to be as soon as possible, too. I want the rapture to be tomorrow. And last time I gave a word about some kind of revival or something. Or the Lord had showed me that there would be a nuclear explosion in the Korean Peninsula. And I made a video about it 3 or 4 times because the Lord has given me more additional information. And then there's someone who messaged me and said, oh, so now we know the rapture will not happen until there's a nuclear bomb. You cannot equate anyone's word, even myself or anybody, I don't care who they are. If somebody gives a word on YouTube, or even in person, it's not knocking YouTube or the internet. There's no man walking the earth today that gives you a word that's going to override what the Bible says. And the Bible says no man knows the day or the hour. Okay, so we know the season. We know we're in the season, that the day would not overtake us as a thief, 1 Thessalonians chapter 5. But we do not know the day or the hour. Only the Lord knows that. So, brothers and sisters, the Lord has shown me that there would be a revival before the rapture. Now, a revival could last for one day, could last for 1 year, 10 years. I don't know. But the Lord said he would do a quick work. And the Lord had showed me. I had a vision of the bride. And the Lord kept showing it to me. I was actually praying with one of my wife's relatives. If you guys have been watching my videos, I told you that when I went to my father-in-law's funeral, a mighty move of the Spirit, during the praise and worship, there was a mighty move of the Holy Spirit through the chapel there at the funeral home, and I was going to speak that night. And we were doing some praise and worship before that with some of the local churches. As a matter of fact, it was the Pastor Raul and his wife and their children who do lots of the feeding programs for us. This is the area where they're at, near where my father-in-law is from, where he was born. And we were there, and mighty move of the Spirit. And then I had a vision there of another relative of my wife dying, or they were caught up. That angel was taking them to heaven, and they were wearing a white robe, but they were like they were dead, and they were being carried to heaven. And so I told my wife about it, and we prayed about it, and we I've been ministering to this person, this relative of my wife and her fiance, and they were here, and I was ministering to them, praying with them, and talking to them, and then the Lord gave me a word for her again, and this is the word from the Lord, is that which, you know, was nowhere in my mind what the Lord would have me tell her. And that's how, one way you know it's the Lord. I never even thought about this, but the Lord gave me the Bible verse, you know, awake thou that sleepeth, and Christ will give you life. So as an example, this is in for, you know, as a teaching for you guys, that never even crossed my mind about what I would tell her or pray for her. But the word from the Lord is, you know, is wake up and repent and get right with God, and you're going to live. We didn't tell this person that I had this vision about her. Just kind of hinted around about it and told her that, you know, we wanted to pray for her because she is a backslider. And she's not in the will of God. She's called to do ministry work. She's not doing it. And so, as an example, I'm just teaching you guys, talking about this. And so, anyway, when I was praying with her, besides getting that word, I saw a vision. And I saw this bride. And I saw this bride, even though it is true that my sister-in-law is about to get married. Well, they don't have a date set yet, but they're engaged to be engaged, I guess is the right word. They just haven't set a date. So I don't know what you call that. Engaged, but no date. Anyway, so I saw a bride, and it was the bride of Christ. And I kept seeing that bride so bright, so bright. And then I saw this warrior coming. I saw this mighty warrior coming. And then carried the bride away on a horse. A white horse and a rider carried the bride on the horse into the sky, and it was the rapture of the church. But just before that, what I was seeing was is the bride was getting brighter and brighter and brighter, and then the Lord told me that He would do a quick work to prepare the bride. You know, that's why the Lord gave me the name of the church. The Lord's just reminding me right now, Church of the Firstborn. That's from Hebrews chapter 12, and it talks about really. It's talking about revival, and it's talking about going to heaven, going to Mount Zion, to the church of the firstborn, the place where the firstborn is. It says where the holy angels are, and where those people who have died, the saints, the holy saints who have gone on before us, and where the Father is, Mount Zion, which is, in this case, is talking about heaven, Hebrews chapter 12. So church of the firstborn is those who are being prepared. That's the mission that the Lord gave me for the church, the online church. To prepare the bride to meet the bridegroom. And that's our whole purpose. That's our whole mission, is to prepare the bride in all those different ways you can think of. People repenting, people doing their ministry work through our website to minister to others, to be prayer warriors, to counsel people, to pray with people, to evangelize people, all that. It's available through the website, Church of the Firstborn, churchfirstborn.com. Anyway, brothers and sisters, what the Lord is telling me, so I said, well, Lord, you know what people always say. Of course, I don't say it in a way that lots of people say it to me in comments. And, you know, I said, well, Lord, you know, everybody's talking about, or, you know, your word says there's a great falling away. And I know the churches have already fallen away. The Lord has given me a word that there would be a revival several times. And then there's always someone who comments, which is true. It says there'll be a great falling away before the, you know, the tribulation period and all that, 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. So I started saying that to the Lord in my mind, praying to the Lord inside my mind as we were here doing praise and worship. And I was getting ready to pray for this relative of my wife and her fiance. And the Lord gave me a text. The Lord said Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11. He quoted that verse to me in my spirit, man. The Lord speaks to us in our spirit. Jesus said, you know, the Holy Spirit can speak to anybody. There's lots of people that don't hear from God because they're not listening. God's always talking and people aren't listening. Just throw that in there. I always do that, brothers and sisters, you know me. To teach you guys something. You know, as they say, give a man a fish, he'll eat for a day. Teach him how to fish, he'll fish for a lifetime. It's like that. Jesus said the Holy Spirit will not speak of himself, but he will speak of those things about me that I want you to know. And I'm paraphrasing in modern English, but the point of that text is the Holy Spirit speaks. And where is the Holy Spirit? He's in the heart of the believers. The Lord is speaking. People have to listen. God is always speaking. Let there be light. God spoke those things into existence. Jesus Christ himself is the Word of God. Anyway, so the Lord gave me that Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11, 12, 13, along in there. And it says, this is the Lord told me, this is the text that There needs to be revival. He gave some apostles, some prophets, some evangelists, some pastors, some teachers for the perfecting of the saints. That's Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11. Then it goes on to say, till we all come together, you know, into the mature body and all this stuff. So the body would be perfected. You have to go read the text. I don't have it up here in front of me. I wasn't intending on sitting here reading it to you. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11, 12, 13. So the body has to be perfected. The church has to be without spot, without wrinkle. People keep talking about that. Well, how is that going to happen? It's already been happening, brothers and sisters. The Lord wants you to know, which lots of you already know. You just haven't had that connection in your mind. I mentioned this in videos before by the inspiration of the Lord, that since 2011, the Lord has been waking up his people. It's a process that's already going on. The revival amongst the Lord's bride has already been going on since 2011. It's the, you know, whenever there's a revival, God moves in different ways, in different seasons, in different times with different people. He's already been moving amongst his people. The reason why you don't see it is because your church is not moving in revival, but individuals like yourself, all the people that I've visited, almost 100%, of course, you know, you always got some that are out there, but almost 100% of the people I've met, brothers and sisters, you know, they're like the only person in their church, the only person in their family who is awake. They're in personal revival, but they're just so, they're just so taken aback by the fact that they're surrounded by sleeping, foolish virgins, foolish people, who claim to be Christians, that they're just caught up in that fact. All of us are. You know, and that's why the Lord had me come on the YouTube, but that's why the Lord had me make this video, brothers and sisters. You know, that word that I just said, you know, wake up, thou that sleepest, arise, and Christ will give you life. That's for the sleeping church. That's the message that the Lord is sending forth. But not everyone will wake up, brothers and sisters. There are those who will only wake up after the rapture occurs. There are those who will only wake up when it's time to take the mark. You know, when they're just like in Joshua, when it says, how long will you be caught between two? You know, or just like with Elijah at Mount Carmel, when he called down the fire from heaven. How long will you be caught between the two? You know, either God is God, Lord, or, you know, the Jezebel's God and her false prophets. This, you know, Baal is God. You know, you need to choose. And then in Joshua, chapter 24, you know, choose this day whom you will serve. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. That day is coming. Different people will get awakened at different times. There are those who will be mighty men and women of God by going up there in front of the whole people, even maybe on TV and all that, and saying, we refuse to take the mark. We will not deny the Lord Jesus Christ. And they will be strong in the Lord and the power of his might and under the grace of his Holy Spirit. They will have their heads chopped off, but they will be at peace and full of joy as they face the lions, as they did in the days of the Roman Empire. They face the lion's den as Daniel did. When they go in there and have their head chopped off and all those things, they will be mighty men and women of God. But that day's not here yet, brothers and sisters. There are those people who will do that are asleep right now, and they will not wake up. Now, we don't know, you don't know, and I don't know who is who, but the Lord knows who is who, which ones and all that in different categories. Those who will be awakened at the rapture, and you know, the thing is too, there'll be famines, pestilence, and earthquakes in diverse places, and there'll be wars and all kinds of stuff going on, and millions of people will die without getting their head cut off. They'll be killed in an earthquake, tsunami, famine, you know, starvation, diseases, all this stuff will be going on. Millions of people who will become saved will be killed in those things also. You know, besides the, you know, the Antichrist going around trying to arrest people and chopping off their heads if they don't take the mark, there's also all the different judgments of God pouring out on the earth. You know, this all of those different ones that'll fall on the earth. You know, the hailstones is and all those giant the weight of a talent and all this kind of stuff. You had to look that up. How much is a talent? I forgot right now. I think it's 340 pounds, something like that. Anyway, not important to my library research friends. It will kill people. Just a hail, a piece of hail, H-A-I-L, falling on you would kill you. Brothers and sisters, these are very serious matters. But for we, by the grace of God, we who, by the grace of God, and I can't say that enough, let me say it again. But we who by the grace of God, not of our own doing, not by our own works, so that we cannot boast, for whatever reason, from the foundation of the world, God chose us to be awake in this season. If God hadn't called us, we would be asleep too. Just like Lazarus, he was asleep. And then the Lord went there and called him out. Almost all the people who I've met and I talked to are coming out of a backslidden state in 2011. Almost all of you guys. It is a miracle, each and every one of you. And that's what I want to tell you right now in my spirit from the Lord. As I already told you, there's going to be a revival. That's what I'm going to try to do in the States. Be forever grateful and humble. Do not be arrogant, because the Bible says when you think you stand, beware when you think you stand, lest you fall. So remember that you are never standing on your own. You're never standing on the works you do. That's the negative part about, you know, trying to be part of the holiness movement, or being, a spirit-filled holiness Christian, is you have to be careful not to become self-righteous, arrogant, and boastful. Okay? You know, we're not talking about being greasy grace, but we're talking about that God is giving you the grace to repent. You could not repent without the grace of God. Don't let anybody give you some universalist tale about how you are in control and you're in charge of your own destiny and all this. Jesus said, no man comes to me unless the Father draws them. When they said, why aren't we following you? Jesus said, you're not my sheep. Just that simple. My sheep hear my voice, and they answer not to another. Jesus said, I've got all the ones that you've given me, Father. He talked about his people. Everyone you've given me I've kept except for one. That's Judas. So brothers and sisters, be grateful today that the Lord called you, and he who has called you is faithful. And it says, he who has begun a good work in you will see it through until the end. Thank God Almighty for his sustaining power of his Holy Spirit, for the sustaining power of his Holy Spirit, and all the mystery of how God operates between our free will and his sovereign destiny for our lives. Praise God for that. It's beyond our understanding in this life. All I know is praise God that he called me, because without God I would be lost and without hope. And I was lost and without hope in this world, as the Bible tells us. And I was an enemy of God before the Lord said, Patrick, called me by name, you know, called me forth, said, Patrick, come unto me, you who are burdened and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. And the Lord has set us free from death, hell, and the grave. And praise God for his grace and mercy, brothers and sisters. I'm going to cut this video off because I had another thing that the Lord has shown me I wanted to talk to you about. Anyway, God bless you guys.